Hello my dear students, welcome to the video. In this series of videos, I am discussing the line by line paraphrase of Shelley's famous poem, Ode to the West Wind. So in this video, I am going to talk about the second canto of the poem. The first canto was about the movement of west wind over the earth. And in the second canto, the writer describes the movement of the wind through the sky and how it affects the clouds and the sky and the weather. So let's get started. The narrator says, "Thou on whose stream," again we can see that the narrator is addressing to someone. So he says, "Thou on whose stream, mid the steep sky's commotion, loose clouds like earth's decaying leaves are shed, shook from the tangled boughs of heaven and ocean." So to understand these lines, we have to imagine that there is this tree, big tree, and heaven and ocean are the branches, the boughs of that tree. So they are entangled. The branches of heaven and ocean are entangled, and when these branches are entangled and the wind is blowing, so clouds are the leaves that are there on the branches of heaven and ocean. So the writer uses this complex image, this complex simile, and he says that heaven and ocean are the branches of a tree. So actually what he wants to say is that on the horizon, when the weather is stormy and it is cloudy and it is windy, so on the horizon, the ocean and the heaven, they seem to be meeting. That is why he says that there are tangled boughs of heaven and ocean, and they seem to be meeting. And since the weather is stormy, so there are a lot of clouds in the sky and they are moving fast because of the power of the west wind. And he has described this simple scene in this image where he has imagined that there is this big tree and heaven and ocean are the tangled branches of that tree, and clouds are the leaves of that big tree, and these clouds are being shed, or they are falling like the dead leaves which we saw in the last canto. So I explain it just once again. He says that, "O west wind, you on whose stream, on your current, on your movement, mid the steep sky's commotion." Steep sky, the sky is steep because it is so high. It seems steep, and there is commotion, that is, there is this disturbance in the sky, there is this storm in the sky. So, "O west wind, on your current, loose clouds are shed like earth's decaying leaves," like the dead leaves are shed on the earth. In the same way, these clouds, they seem to be like the dead leaves because they are, there are many, many clouds in the sky, and they seem to be shed from the tangled branches of heaven and ocean. So the heaven and the ocean, they seem to be meeting at the horizon, and the clouds, they seem as if they are the leaves which are falling off this tree of heaven and ocean. "Angels of rain and lightning." Now these angels are the clouds. So these clouds are the angels of rain and lightning, because they are the ones who bring rain and who cause lightning. And then the writer says, "There are spread on the blue surface of thine airy surge, like the bright hair uplifted from the head of some fierce maenad." So he uses a simile here, and first we understand this image and then we'll understand the meaning. So maenad is the female follower of the Greek god of wine, Bacchus. So since she is the follower of god of wine, she is always intoxicated, and since she is intoxicated, her hair are disheveled, they are mismanaged, they are they are not in the best of their shape. So this maenad, her hair are uplifted, they are disheveled, they are uplifted, and these hair, when the wind blows, they are uplifted from her head, And the writer uses, he uses this simile to describe the clouds that are there and the storm that is there in the sky. So take it again. He says, there are spread on the blue surface of thine airy surge. Airy surge, O wind, your airy current. On your airy current, these clouds or these locks of the approaching storm, these clouds are spread like the hair of this female follower of Bacchus called Maenad, even from the dim verge of the horizon to the zenith's height. And where are these clouds spread? From the dim verge of horizon to the zenith's height. Zenith is the highest point in the sky. So from the horizon, from the dim verge, why dim? Because it is not clearly perceptible, not clearly visible because of the clouds and the stormy weather. So from the dim verge of the horizon to the zenith's height, that is all through the sky. All through the sky, these clouds are spread like the hair of Maenad, and these clouds, they are the locks of the approaching storm. Locks of the approaching storm, because they are the harbingers, they are the announcers of the storm which is imminent, the storm which is about to come. So, the thought is very simple. The writer here wants to say that, wild west wind, you blow so powerfully that you take all the clouds with you, and these clouds are scattered across the sky, and these clouds, they are like the announcement of an imminent storm, a storm which is about to come. And he uses this simple scene with the help of this image, where he compares the clouds to the uplifted hair of Maenad. And he says, thou dirge, thou, again west wind, and you are the dirge, dirge, song of death. So you are the dirge, and then he continues in the next lines, thou dirge of the dying year. Again, the year has been personified, and the year is dying. The year has died actually, and the west wind seems to be the dirge or the death song of the dying year. And he says, to which this closing night, the year has died, and this closing night, this night will be the dome of a vast sepulchre. Sepulchre is a chamber for the dead, that is, it is a grave. So this night will be the dome of the grave which is being built, which is created for the dying year. Vaulted with all thy congregated might, congregated, collected. So this dome, it is full of the collected might of vapors. Collected might of vapors, that is, there are clouds and storm all around, from whose solid atmosphere black rain and fire and hail will burst. Oh, hear. So he, the scene that the narrator wants to describe is very simple. He says that the year is going, because it is the time of winter, or it is the time of autumn, and the year is going, and this whole earth, it seems to be like a grave for all the dead things. All the leaves are falling, all the nature is going into hibernation. So this whole earth, it seems to be the grave of the dying year, and this grave is full of the collected might of the vapors and clouds which are there in the sky. So he says, we take it once again, he uses this simile, he uses this image that the year has died, and the year has died, and the whole earth is the grave, and this night is the bed chamber of that of that year, and it is full of the congregated might, the collected power of the vapors which will create rain and fire and hail. And he says, oh, hear, oh west wind, please listen to me, I have something to say to you, please listen to me. So this is all for this canto. See you in the next video where I will discuss the third canto of the poem. Thank you.